Oh, yeah. Hi, everyone. I'm Audrey. Thanks for joining us and me and Baby Seal for a very interesting talk today. Is it good? Oh, yeah, it says Baby Seal is still silent. Still silent, it seems. Maybe it's that's weird. But if you can hear me, then you should be able to hear Clark as well.
They should be able to hear me. Can they hear me?
Yeah, it should be connected though.
Yeah. I mean, they can hear me now.
They can hear me now. Okay. Okay.
All right. Well, hey guys. Hey everybody. It's because he had Sleepy's. He had my voice channel assigned to him, and we had to boot him out, unfortunately. Hey everybody, quick change in plans. I know you guys were all expecting Sleep Easy here. Unfortunately, he's got a very last minute medical issue with some family and friends stuff, so we all wish him really well. He wanted me to tell you guys he's really, really sorry. He wishes he could be here, and personal apology to Audrey, who he's been
no worries.
He's been running around in circles, just absolutely having a fan freak out about you. So he definitely wanted to be here, and I'm sure one day in the future.
Problem. I hope his family is better.
Yeah, absolutely.
Gets well soon.
So guys, obviously I'm very excited to have Audrey, who has been sort of instrumental in the fan and theory crafting world. I think if we go back all the episodes of SEAL Team 7, there are none where Audrey's translations or Audrey herself haven't been mentioned. So that's that's the kind of importance that she has to the conversation we're having here. So this is SEAL Team 7. We're going to be real brief with introductions. I'm Schrodingersbabyseal. This is my main contribution to the fandom, although some of you know me from my mythology morsels. I have an educational background in mythology and Judaica, so things like Kabbalah and stuff like that. So that's kind of the lore direction I usually come from when I'm doing theory crafting, and I'm just a big old Final Fantasy VII nerd as it is. So that's me, and I'm really, really, really pleased to introduce Audrey, who's going to tell us a little bit about what she does. If you check chat, I have links to everything that she does. And if you're watching this on YouTube, please check the comments or check the title cards, because all of that information will be available. So take it away, Audrey.
Oh, thank you, Clark, for inviting me to your channel. I'm Audrey. I'm iDaikimoti on Twitter. I actually am not a professional translator, but I do translate things for fun. I live in Japan. I own a company that's an e-commerce company that ships all different types of like video game anime merchandise abroad to our customers who live all around the world. My company name is Aitai Japan, and our website is aitaikuji.com. So while I'm doing that like full time, I run a company of about 20 people. But I do these translations because I myself am just a fan. So I just do it for fun. Whatever I can contribute to the different fandoms that I'm in, I'm more than happy to be able to do so as much as I can. So for all of these different Final Fantasy VII Remake Ultimanias, it is, just my pleasure to contribute however much I can. Cannot hear you.
Man. That one was that one was my fault for sure.
No worries.
I can't really quantify how important it is what you do for us, but also, like, you know, it is a very valuable and expensive thing you do. Like, I know because I've had to recently like pay for some translation. So I don't know if there is enough support we can give you for what you do, because it's a very, like, translating a novel, for instance, I mean, that is not a cheap thing. And you know, so for you to even like give us the little tidbits of the novel that you did, but more importantly the Ultimania stuff, that's a big deal. But you know, part of the reason I had you on here is because I've watched you and I listen to you stream. You've great stream presence, by the way. If you ever want to watch a really fun stream, Audrey stream, whenever she streams, it's really fun to watch. She streams a bunch of stuff, not just Final Fantasy VII, not just Final Fantasy XIV, but, you know, anything. And it's really fun to watch her stream those two things. But, whenever you post your translation, sometimes you'll put in as a, like, response tweet. You never like solely the tweet with your opinion, but you will give a little opinion underneath of, you know, hey, what I think this means. And one of the things that that you were an early supporter of, and I remember the very first time that I played 7 Remake, I had this kind of takeaway too. It made me uncomfortable to have this takeaway, but it was this idea that maybe, just maybe, this time around, Sephiroth wasn't going to be the bad guy, and that they were building to a redemption arc. And so, you know, what I'd like to talk to you about is that topic. And, you know, Sleep Easy, by the way, he would have been this incredibly polarizing force on this, because I'm kind of 50-50 on this. I think I see that it could possibly go in the direction that he gets a redemption arc. I still think that Sleep Easy is so vehemently opposed to that you know, he would have been a good counterbalance. But now with our combined force, Sephiroth is for sure going to get redeemed. So do you want to tell me what you think? What made you think that maybe Sephiroth might get a redemption arc?
Yeah, I think when I first played FF VII Remake, I mean, I'm not like married to the idea that of course Sephiroth's going to be redeemed. Yeah. It's totally up to whatever happens with the development and the story and so forth. But like when I was playing the remake, I could tell, without all of these Ultimanias even happening, like in my head, I was like, huh, it seems like Sephiroth is kind of different in all of these like scenes. He's either really, really weird, like, you know, like, and friendly, oddly friendly, or like he's like crazy psycho villain, you know?
Right.
So I thought that there would be something hinting that, like, oh, maybe, I don't know, Sephiroth like knows something, or maybe we're looking at different Sephiroths, I'm not sure. But then when I got to the end of Final Fantasy VII Remake, at the Edge of Creation scene, and then Sephiroth is like talking in a really nice way, and then I was like, oh, this Sephiroth kind of reminds me of Crisis Core Sephiroth, where he's very like calm, and like especially where Cloud says like, oh, like he says something like, oh no, like never, or he's never going to like help Sephiroth with attaining his goal or whatever. And then Sephiroth looks down for a little bit, like he's actually kind of like sad that he can't, you know, persuade Cloud to join him. I thought like, oh, maybe this is not the evil Sephiroth we're looking at. Maybe he's like a nice Sephiroth. and then that like thought I just kind of had for a while. And then when the first Ultimania book came out in the end of April, I believe it was April 29th or something, or early May or that it came out, it did confirm that there are different Sephiroths in the book, in the game. And so when I read that, I was like, oh, okay, well then maybe if there are different Sephiroths, does that mean that there's one Sephiroth that's like a bad guy and the other one's a good guy that's trying to get rid of the bad guy, or like who's the ultimate bad guy,
you right
know? I think there's a lot of gray area. Final Fantasy VII, the story in general is kind of like good guys are bad guys can be good guys. It's like a lot of gray, blurred line.
Right.
So I think that might be a theme going forward.
So I had the same takeaway when I watched the ending, and it was like, he seems very tender. Like, Sephiroth seems very tender, and what I didn't know is whether or not that was the English localization, because there's a very dramatic tone shift, I kind of went down that rabbit hole too, and so you start to look at all the pieces and see, well, why is Sephiroth good now? Is it a different Sephiroth? You know, now there's these four forms of Sephiroth, and I thought we could go over some of the context information, and and so I will go over that. Sleep Easy was going to present this, but I've got his back this time. And so the first thing that was really something that when the game first came out and Sleep Easy and I were really digging into what everything meant, one of the things we noticed is that there seemed to be this mixed connection between the Whispers and Sephiroth, where he seemed to be both an antagonist of the Whispers and somehow reliant on them and part of their nature. Let me just pull this up here.
Yeah, I think the material Ultimania Plus, one of the passages that I translated recently for chapter 18, where they explain how the Whisperers were like surrounding Cloud and everyone at the highway, and then Sephiroth cuts into the portal or whatever, the wall of Whispers. I think like what you said, where he's also reliant but also defiant against them, it kind of relates to that scene perhaps, because after he cuts the hole in the wall of Whispers, it says that the Whispers appear like liquefied and in a different form.
Yes, actually.
That goes into the singularity area. So I think I'm not sure like the connection, but there's definitely something that is there.
And there's something there. And actually, so for context on that page too, that was like the page 126 on the Ultimania Plus. That was one of those pages that when I was looking at it through Google Translate, I'm like, uh-oh, there's something seriously here. And so I immediately hit you up, even though you just put out this message saying, hey, I'm super busy, I can't translate stuff right now. I'm like, please translate this. And of course, that ended up being a huge, huge deal. That page in particular has some of the heaviest dialogue. For context, what that is that is the dialogue between the party and Sephiroth at the end of the highway before going into the portal, the singularity. That in the Materials Plus Ultimania, there's the entire voice script, and the voice script has both like context that was meant for localizer. So it's not stuff that we, the audience, see, but the localization team saw when trying to translate. And then there's there's also these red text sections, which are after the fact input by either Motomo Toriyama or somebody related. And so this scene, some of the subtext was like very interesting, particularly the part you just mentioned and about it being liquefied and being like a sea of of insects and, or, you know, like what the language that they used was very reminiscent of all things of the final verse of Loveless by Genesis.
Oh,
I know.
Interesting.
I know. So
I'm disclaimer, I'm not like a huge lore person. I just play the game. I enjoy the game and that's about it. Like, I enjoy the characters. I never really go into like the lore. So I probably will be like very, very like, oh, I never thought about that during this call.
That's great. There's too many people like us. So the more people like we have you to ground the conversation, the better. Because we get way weird. Okay. But so, okay. So the similarities between the Whispers and Sephiroth, right? So there's this juxtaposition of these two things, like where it's clear that he's attacking the Whispers, you know, and he wants you to defy destiny, and these are the harbingers of fate. But there are things about these Whispers that really reek of Jenova and Sephiroth. The three Whispers, the three main Whisper harbingers, Rubrum, Viridae, and Criseo, are confirmed analogs of Kadaj, Yazoo, and Laz. And we wouldn't know that without you in the West, by the way. Like, we would have no idea. Like, I would never have guessed that based on looking at them. Like, when I first played the game, I looked at the assessments. I'm like, oh, these are weird creatures from the future that are harbingers of fate. But, like, the Ultimania, you know, makes this connection. And then the Materials Ultimania, like, furthered the connection by saying that Viridae would actually had like a specialized animation against Tifa, just like Laz did. Mm-hmm. And so like, and so, okay. So we've got these are remnants of Sephiroth. And so for those of you that don't know who the remnants are, they were the three, there were three like elements of Sephiroth's will that appeared in Final Fantasy VII Advent Children. So they're the three silver haired, like teenagers that Cloud fights and eventually become Sephiroth, or one of them like eats Jenova and becomes Sephiroth. And so these aren't just like Sephiroth clones, these are part of Sephiroth. So Sephiroth made them in the live stream by being really mad at Cloud. That's a very simplified way of saying that. That's explained in On the Way to a Smile live stream Black and White, that whole process. Then we get to the actual big harbinger. The Whisper Harbinger is like, the Whisper Harbinger kind of looks like a big Jenova form. There's that. But he's also comprised of the same purple essence that like trailed the presidential office, that blood. Purple, if you watch any of Sleep Easy's videos, like, should be like a huge trigger that means like evil or Sephiroth. Like, Sephiroth is constantly surrounded in purple. And then finally, like, one of the references that the Cetra had for Jenova was Heaven's Dark Harbinger. And so there's that, you know, there's those alone. The other like seemingly obviously ones are like the Whispers themselves, or the Feelers, look like hooded clones. Like, they've got hoods, you know, there's one called in English, it's called the Enigmatic Specter. But I think in Japanese, it's it's something crazy, like the Demon of Nihilism or something like that. And
Enigmatic Specter, F7. Let me see. I don't remember seeing that.
It's something way better than Enigmatic Spectre. I just remember feeling very cheated.
I have to check the Ultimania. I'll check it in.
That sounds back good.
Later.
Yeah. One, it's purple as opposed to, you know, the regular black that everything else. And all of its attacks are attacks that Sephiroth has used through various games, right? So it's like that purple specter like acts like Sephiroth. And at one point, it looms over Cloud's face and uses the voice of Sephiroth. Like, says, sleep now, right, sleep the sweetest dreams. So what is going on, right? So why do some of the whispers seem like they are controlled by Sephiroth? And why is he antagonizing Cloud into like defeating his own fate? And where my brain went early on in my theory crafting career here is that what we were witnessing is some kind of like cognitive dissonance, right? So like we're looking at an internal battle between Sephiroth and Genova. So that's kind of where my brain went. So I will tell you that personally, I'm not a big fan of that direction. I'm not necessarily happy that they go there. I'm not saying they couldn't pull it off. Like, they've pulled off everything in this game really well. But I'm, you know, there's a lot of risks when you like redeem a villain. It gets into like trope territory. So I'm a little worried, but what are you going to do, right? So as
yeah, that's true.
But I will tell you, as I've let the material sunk in, and the materials Ultimania came out, and then the plus came out, I've actually shifted back. I think that both Sephiroth is trying to gain some independence from Genova, but I think he's even worse than before. And the reason I think that is you, and I'll let you get into some stuff after this, but in the bit that you translated on 126, the dialogue, one of the first things that happens is that we get an indication that Aerith from the get knows that this Sephiroth is different. And we can kind of assume that based on seeing the scene, but it's not like there's some subtitle that says, you know, Aerith knows that this guy's bullshit, you know? But we do see from her like behavior, like you're wrong, like you're incorrect about this stuff. And so,
right.
So I think that this Sephiroth is something that Aerith is aware of. It's probably like they've been battling back and forth, you know, in the future or whatever. And she sees right through him. But he is still significantly different and detached from the Sephiroth that we know. So I don't know what that means for the story, but, you know, what are you going to do?
Yeah, like, I think what I assumed is that there is going to be there's going to be the Sephiroth, who is the ultimate bad guy Sephiroth. And whether that's, like, you know, related to Genova or Genesis or whatever, like, I don't think it really matters, but there is also going to be a Sephiroth who is not the bad guy Sephiroth.
Yeah.
And that not bad guy Sephiroth, that's a mouthful, will be someone key to defeating the ultimate bad guy Sephiroth. So in the end, like, still going to be a Sephiroth who's the, you know, the last villain or whatever. But I feel like it will be a combination of, like, that Sephiroth plus, like, whatever other evil forces, like, let's say it's Genova or Genesis or whatever. Like, I think it will be something that they'll merge or they're combined with each other to be the ultimate villain at the end.
Live stream.
And sort, then, yeah. Yeah, and then maybe there's that one Sephiroth who we saw at the edge of creation. If he's the good Sephiroth, I don't know. But, like, perhaps Sephiroth will inadvertently also assist in defeating himself. Like, I think, it's like a crazy theory. But I think, it kind of makes sense if there's going to be all these what's the point of telling us there are four different Sephiroths if it doesn't have some kind of impact in the future where we either are fighting four different ones or they're going to merge into the ultimate one, or there's one that, you know, branches off from the four and that one is not the evil one, you know?
Yeah.
I think there's a lot that can happen. So I also just now checked the name of the other feeler. Or sorry, they're called feeler in Japanese, but it's whisper. It's a kyomunaru mamono, which is like a monster that is made out of nothingness, out of nothingness.
That's
a monster of nothingness.
That's badass. I like that. That's way better. What's
it called? Enigmatic specter.
Yeah.
In English.
Yeah. And I mean, like, it's, you know, we got mysterious specters and then enigmatic specter, and it's like, all right, yeah, I get
it. Right.
You're different, but
yeah.
I'm not saying that the localization team did a bad job. They did great. It's very hard to localize a game, but. Did you?
Yeah, one of them is called the Unknown Spectre, and the one that's a little purple, which is interesting because you mentioned the purple thing. That one is the Spectre of Nothingness.
Right. That's interesting. Enigmatic Spectre is built different, Gene. You're right. So okay, what do you think of that? By the way, like, do you think that just we won't devolve into like making you, you know, talk negatively about Final Fantasy VII, but do you think that's a good idea?
It doesn't matter. I have my own opinions. You mean about the Sephiroth being redeemed thing, or
no, like the idea that maybe at the end it's going to be Cloud, Zack, Aerith, good Sephiroth, Kadaj, revived Aerith, Jesse, Barack Obama versus evil mega Sephiroth. You think that's a good storytelling?
I mean, it depends on what the direction the devs want to take the story is. Like, do they want the story to end? I don't think so. I think they're going to try to milk the story as much as possible. So like, let's say there's four installments. Let's say there's three or four installments. That means that in the next, let's say 10 years, we'll be playing these games. Right. Uh-huh. And then, like at the end of the game, do they want to call it like, that's it, you know, FF7 is done, or do they want it to be, something that continues indefinitely? Like, you know, like Kingdom Hearts, for example. So I guess it really depends on where first the goal of the development team is.
Mm-hmm.
For me personally, if all of the people who are supposed to be dead come back and fight against like the ultimate Genesis Sephiroth Genova, I don't know, like merge form or whatever, as long as the story leading up to it makes sense, I don't really. It doesn't bother me. Like, it could be cheesy as hell,
yeah,
but I don't care, because like, if I mentioned this in the previous stream that I had about the Ultimania, but like, as long as the development like of the story makes sense, then it's totally like, I'm totally down. And even if it is kind of something that like people will be like, oh, that's like stupid, or like, that's such a Disney ending, or like, what are they even doing with this character? They totally ruined the character. But like, honestly, like, the developers, they are the ones who should know the most about each character, right? So maybe if they went that a certain direction with a character that goes against what the other, you know, like, audience thinks, perhaps the audience interpreted the character incorrectly then. Yeah, there's always like that kind of,
you hear that, guys?
Accent, right?
You're wrong about the characters. Per Audrey.
I mean, not necessarily wrong, but no, like, if the developers say it this way, of course people will be like, well, that's stupid as hell. But like, what can you do? Like, as the audience, like, you can rebel against that. You can hate it, but it won't change what was already made. So instead of like being angry about like, you know, something like that happening, for some, you know, whatever you have that in your head that you want it to happen,
totally.
It doesn't happen.
Yeah.
Instead of being angry at that, my way of viewing things is just like, well, at least I had fun, you know, throughout the journey. At least I had fun, and at least like, there's some moments that brought, you know, happiness and a moment of reprieve from everyday, you know, hectic life. that's what video games are, right?
Yeah.
It's not something to like stress out too much about. I know like in my previous stream, I was making an analogy with like how, like, let's say Game of Thrones. Game of Thrones ended really shittily, or at least that's the general consensus, right?
Yeah, yeah.
And people do have, you know, definitely they have the complete right to be super critical and hate the ending or whatever. But like, I'm sure at least each individual found something that they really did enjoy throughout the entire journey, right? So if you just focus on the good part instead of how, you know, everything went to shit at the end, if it does, I think that's the most important part, the journey rather than the ending itself. But yeah, I mean, for me, I wouldn't mind if Sephiroth is redeemed, or not like, okay, so like there's four Sephiroths apparently or whatever the hell. Like at least if there's one Sephiroth who is like the crisis core Sephiroth, pre like Genova psychoness, craziness, then if that Sephiroth even makes an inkling of an appearance, I would be happy.
So, yeah, and that's actually, okay. So I'm going to say something that will probably surprise people that know me. I think that Sephiroth, prior to Crisis Core, and even after, really, a little flat. Like, there really isn't much to Sephiroth. Like, the Sephiroth's role in the story was really effective. Like, he was really, like, it was a scary, larger-than-life Jaws. Like, he had no real... But as an actual developed character, he was just like a random soldier and then an alien. It's hard to even call that evil. Like, there's something inherently that doesn't bite if the character's motive is something so foreign that it's hard to even classify as anything but like survival. And that's all that Genova was. Like, her classification was that she just came to different planets and basically feasted on their life stream. Like, that's a force of nature. That isn't inherently evil. There's no malice there, just survival. And Sephiroth was like a normal but kind of emo soldier that was very lonely, ran into an alien that happened to be like his mother, or like partly his mother, you know, through convoluted video game genetics. And then all of a sudden he's just a psychopath, right? Now, what Crisis Core did for us is it sort of showed the inherent tragedy of that story. And and so there's this soldier that's got like friends, and he shows tenderness, like he lets Zack go be with Aerith and stuff like that, and you know, asks about Cloud's hometown and is like, oh, what's that like? And it's just like this kind of sad story. I can see them leaning into like developing a backstory to make him more relatable. But I think
they will with the first soldier.
That's right. There's going to be a segment of the first soldier that is about him, that is written by,
like, specifically about his childhood.
Yeah.
So, I think like there are already wheels being set in motion that is supposed to flesh out Sephiroth's character in a empathetic way, where the audience could be like, "Aw, that sucks," you know?
Yeah, but I think there's a chance that what that really means is that you know, there's all these characters have had tragic backstories. Like, Cloud's story is very tragic. Tifa's story is very tragic. It's the game is a host of characters that are orphans. And the difference, though, between Cloud and Sephiroth, ultimately, is how they respond to that. And, you know, and so I really do think that they do risk losing, you know, the DNA of Final Fantasy VII with the Sephiroth redemption arc. And I'm starting to feel, especially with the way that Nojima wrote, you know, the bits of Traces of Two Paths that I've been able to get my hands on. There's there's this real clear understanding of what the themes of Final Fantasy VII were for fans. And for people that are really worried about Nojima in particular, like saving characters or, you know, making everything really consequence-free, I will recommend that you check out his Twitter, because he generally posts about hamsters and then and then Game of Thrones, and his favorite movie of the last decade was Midsommar. And if you watched Midsommar, nobody makes it out of that movie. Like, so his recent interests have been like a total blood fest. So just, you know, things could still go rough. But, you know, of course, not a single person is like in charge of the story of Final Fantasy VII. You know, it's like this, you know, collaboration between all these different minds. One of the things about For Sephiroth. Now, there was something in Ultimania, and I don't know if you wanted to, you have time to clarify it at all, but it was about Sephiroth, and primarily it was in Ultimania Plus, and it said that it was Toriyama was asked about the four Sephiroth forms, and he said that basically they're all being controlled by the same will, all four forms.
Oh, right. Let me pull that one up. Was that from the 7 seconds scene, or was that a different scene?
That was a different scene.
It was from the Ultimania Plus, though.
Yeah,
I do remember it was recent. Let me just... Right, but I do remember him saying something that, like, they're all... I don't know if it was bound by the same will. Let me quickly pull it up so I can reread it. I just don't remember exactly which scene it was from originally. Do you remember the...
I'm trying to find if it was even a scene that you had it associated with. And I, of course, look at the book, and it's, I look at the pictures hope it does the best it can to get me in the right direction.
Okay, here we go. It's from chapter 2. There's various Sephiroths throughout the story, and they all apparently share a similar goal. And let me see. Position in the book. I guess, like, for those who are curious, this is what the book looks like. It's a very thick book. Over, I think, 200 something pages. It's a hardcover book, though, so.
Yeah, it's got a lot of beautiful
interesting stuff here.
Beautiful art.
Yeah, too. There's a lot of art in it, and a lot of, I think the main bulk of it is the voice script that
voice script.
Like, what the voice script is, so it says over here in the beginning of the section, like, what it is, this voice shuroku daifon. So basically it means, like, this is the script that they, when they're recording, like, they refer to this script. So basically, like, all of these little stuff that you see where it's like in italics that I translated from the script, like, those are all written there for the actors to kind of understand, like, the psyche of the characters and the context of the scene.
Oh.
So I think you mentioned this earlier, Clark, but, like, this would be what they would send to get it localized, to get it translated. And then the voice actors in the localizations would also see this as their script. So that's why it's called voice script. So, all of these, like, insights and stuff are written, like, how it should be spoken. So it's like, let's say it says Sephiroth is, like, you know, saying that this is a flashback to Cloud's mom, like, dying words or whatever, right? So, like, that's written in the script So when the voice actor sees that line, they he can, you know, think like, okay, how will I deliver my line? So that's what this is, voice script. And I don't know if that's like clear, like in the translations, but it's like actual, you know, dialogue that happens within the game and with specific cues for the actors. So anyway, let me just look at this one again. Okay, so there's different Sephiroths. Oh yeah, it says that they are all talk about the same similar goals. And they all kind of like toy with Cloud's heart. Yeah, that is in Toriyama's question and answer. So what exactly is the goal though? Was that made clear?
Oh, never. And that's the thing we probably internally debate about the most in this in this silly fandom is what does Sephiroth want? And the answer seems to always revolve around Cloud in either a thirsty way or not, depending on who you ask. But the okay. I think there's a kind of general consensus that it has to do with the end of Dirge of Cerberus, with Genesis. And I'm hoping Omega? That it's... Yeah, Omega. So Omega being, you know, sort of the method by which, like, all of the live stream is collected from a planet and taken to a new one. This seems to
what
be...
What exactly happened at the end of Dirge of Cerberus? I don't quite remember. It was like over 15, maybe almost 15 years ago that I played it.
You know, I don't think we have enough time. No, it's so silly. It's pretty silly, and it feels very silly to watch. But long story short is like there's this battle between Chaos and Omega. But at the end, there's a secret credit scene where, like, after you've beat Vice and a bunch of Gak sings him. Gak comes right. out and he says a loveless line. We don't know it's a loveless line at the time, but he's in this underwater cave underneath Midgar,
right.
And so we don't know what his real goal is, but and as strange as this is, the only clue we have comes from Ultimania's, and he's now the champion of Minerva, and Minerva is the will of the planet. So in some strange way, Genesis is now like a champion of the planet, and whether that's good or bad is unclear at this point. So it does get kind of convoluted when you get into Genesis stuff. But let's say that's not what's happening. Let's say that it's, you know, they're kind of doing a soft retcon of it. If you watch any of Sleep Easy's videos, it's not like he's saying that everything's being retconned. What he's saying is that this is truly a remake. The story is being retold, but with bits of the compilation now, you know, canonized into the series under one roof, because Dirge of Cerberus was not written by Nojima. Like, he was not the scenario writer. It was the guy that did Final Fantasy Type Zero and World of Final Fantasy, and so its style feels very different. Like, it feels like Kojima trying to do a Final Fantasy game, like with the sviets of color and all that weird stuff. So it feels really different. But what it seems like is happening with Remake is that the original story is being told, but with all these elements of the compilation. Like, I know that in the original materials, Ultimania, they have like they have the storyboarding section of all the different battle scenes, and the battle scene for the final battle between Sephiroth and Cloud is just straight up referred to as the AC scene, and I don't think that stands for air conditioning. I don't know Japanese. But I get the sense that's Advent Children. And, you know, there's a bunch of stuff from Advent Children in that fight. There's a bunch of Advent Children, like, iconography, and then, you know, we get intermission, and it's like our chance to look at Deep Ground, but under the guise of, you know, of Remake, under the tutelage of this new, you know, contained lore. And so I'm not sure if, you know, if we're supposed to know. It's clear we're actually not supposed to know what Sephiroth wants. We just know that it's either the destruction of the universe or something, or actually, I guess we don't know that. We know that he wants to keep the planet alive, but he wants to keep it alive in a different way than Aerith thinks is good. Like, and we only know that because of, like, that last translation of page 126 that, like, that's a really strange thing about whatever motivates him. He either wants that, or he wants Cloud's body. It's like one of those two things. So,
well, the will of the planet. So in the translation that I posted, I think 2 days ago, it does explain that Sephiroth thinks that in order to like save the planet or prolong the planet, he has to sacrifice people.
Right.
So that kind of ties into what you mentioned, that Minerva is the embodiment of the will of the planet, right?
Yeah.
Technically, with the Dirge of Cerberus lore. So does that mean that who we need to defeat at the end would be something related to Minerva?
I mean, defeating the planet seems contrary to the party's interest on account of them living upon the planet, but I don't know. Like, it seems like I would put hard money on Minerva being like a super secret boss fight in part 2 or 3, like for sure. Because she was like the mega.
Wait, did we see Minerva?
Yeah, she's a super boss in Crisis Core.
Okay. So she's a boss.
Yeah, she's like a secret boss. She's like Vice, like in Remake, like. You see Minerva's statue and you see Minerva in the end of Crisis Core, but they're like, but you don't fight her unless you, you know, do the new game plus stuff. And she's easily the hardest fight in the game. She's actually one of the hardest fights in all of Final Fantasy. Like, she has something like, I don't know, she's got like 100 million hit points or something dumb like that.
it takes
like hours, yeah. And she looks like a Cetra. She's got a bunch of, like, all of her clothing, it's like a mixture of yellow and purple, which is like, you know, the juxtaposition of good and evil. If you look at you know, the yellow flower and then purple being like a symbol of Genova,
Sephiroth or evil.
And,
yeah. Oh, I just Googled like Minerva boss, and I'm like looking at it right now. Oh, interesting. I've never seen this before.
it goes pretty deep with Minerva too. Minerva is one of my favorite topics. I'll try not to geek out too hard in front of my friends here, but Minerva is really interesting from a mythological perspective too. So much mythology goes into generally Final Fantasy, but Final Fantasy VII in particular really leans into like the connection between religion and mythology. All of the Cetra lore and like old world lore is all related to like Norse mythology. And then some Greek mythology and some Roman or Etruscan mythology. And everything that Genova and Sephiroth and Genesis, all of those represent like Judaic lore, like things from Christian religion and mythology. So like Genova basically means new God. It's the mixture of the word Jehovah and Nova, which means new god, and Sephiroth they're part of the Kabbalah. They're the 10 emanations of Ein Sof, and so it's like the will of God would be like a kind of a simplification. So Sephiroth means the will of Genova, and then we've got Genesis, you know, Book of Genesis, Angeal, which is just like, you know, angel misspelled.
Angel.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. It just, you know, angel misspelled. And, you know, so that all the things that generally represent Christianity will are represented through Genova. And you can actually make an argument that this is a sort of a, I don't want to say criticism, because I don't think anybody's critical of anything here, but just sort of a retelling of the way that Christianity came and actually destroyed mythology in the parts of the world that Final Fantasy VII is kind of meant to represent. You know, Midgar was based on New York, and so, you know, we could go way into that, but something interesting about Minerva is Minerva has a lot of DNA in her, like, mythological evolution that takes her from old mythology and even connects her to the Virgin Mary. And that's a controversial position. I'm not saying that's actually true, but I'm saying that it can be interpreted that way by people who really know mythology, like Nojima. And in the original Japanese version of Crisis Core, the statue of Minerva looks like the Virgin Mary. They actually changed it for the international edition so that it wouldn't offend anybody's religious sensibilities. So what Minerva is she's almost like a mixture of the two worlds. Like, she's a combination of the two concepts. Like, so it's almost like Sleepeasy's kind of take on it is maybe it is a Cetra that was corrupt by Genova. So, yeah.
Oh, interesting.
Yeah, you can fall
so deep.
But
that's not really explained at any of the Crisis Core story beats, right?
No, not at all. Mm. It's all just huge conjecture based on, you know, nothing but obsessive looking and, like, and then, but loveless too. Like, you say the Crisis Core story beats, but what are the Crisis Core story beats? Like, I've played Crisis Core a lot, and it's there's a lot to that game that is not made really clear to the people that are, like, watching the game. Like, there's the emotional beats and stuff like that, but apparently Loveless super matters to play Loveless. Like, it's supposed to be a prophecy. Like, we go into the underground cavern and we find out that the play, the Loveless, actually is talking about stuff. It was written by the Cetra thousands of years ago. It's talking about the War of the Beasts. Genesis is somehow involved. The world's going to end. So this dumb play, you know, is expressed in Crisis Core.
Wait, it's written by the Cetra?
Yeah. But it's been, like, heavily mistranslated, but it's in the Benora Underground. When you go in the Benora Underground, you find out that that's where Genesis was raised. He had a little, like, playpen area, like, right at the entrance of the Benora Underground. It's where he invented Benora Dumb Apple Juice. Like, you know, in Remake, when you're going, you see those big Benora juice posters. Yeah. Genesis invented that drink as a child.
Oh, and this is written in, like, the reports or something in Crisis Core?
No, you actually, when you go, you find that when you go to the Benora Underground, you find his little desk, and that's one of those things it's like, you can probably skip it, but if you hit the X on the desk and it, you know, says this is, you know, this dumb apple juice was made into this delicious drink. And then so then you go down into the Benora Underground and you fight Genesis as Zack. And down there, like, everything looks like the City of the Ancients. Like, the architecture is the same. They've got the same little plants. And then you find these tablets called the Cetra tablets, and they have the original version of Loveless on there. So it's like the five acts of Loveless, but they're different than the ones that are out publicly and have been turned into a play in Midgar. And you find out that it was actually that humanity or Shinra or somebody turned the Cetra prophecies into a stage play, like the first three acts, but that the fifth act is still being written or is lost, and it's this big convoluted mess, and I feel silly for knowing so much about it.
No, I don't remember. Like, I mean, I played Crisis Core, I don't know, back in 2007 or 2008 or something like that when it came out.
Did you play it in Japanese?
I only played it once. No, I played it in English, and I only played it once, and then that was it. So, like, all of the references that might have come out of it, all of the lore, I have no idea. I just remember I played it, and I got to the end scene, and it was sad as hell, and then, yeah. I don't even think I read many of the texts that came through the cell phone that, like, you know, you get texts and stuff like that. I don't even think I read those.
That's probably for your benefit.
For the better. Yeah. For sanity. Well, I mean, okay, so given that, given all of that from Genesis and so forth, like, I mean, yeah, I think it's very clear by this point that, you know, this is a remake, or this is not even just a remake. This is a sequel, or, you know, like a different timeline, or I talked about this in my previous stream as well, but like, it's either a different timeline, different universe, or whatever, what have you. Mm-hmm. But like, it's clear that to me that this story is just being remade in a sense that it is a sequel, but it's like the ultimate version of what the developers want to do with all of the characters and how it ties into all of the compilations, right? So going back to what we discussed a few topics before earlier,
right.
Like when I said, like, you know, at the end of, let's say, part four, let's say there's four parts at the end of part four, like, you know, everyone bands together and defeats the ultimate evil. Like, at that point, you know, like, what does the developers see as the end goal? Right. So like, if everyone does die as usual, like, you know, then, will they be able to make a sequel out of a sequel, or will they be able to do spin-offs? You know, like, what is their end goal? So maybe by thinking about what their end goal is, maybe they're going to purposely convolute and purposely make some things like really out of character or whatever.
Yeah.
Just for the sake of prolonging the series. Like, that is definitely a possibility on a business side. And mm-hmm. I think that is going to anger a lot of fans, but at the same time, I feel like the fans would buy it anyway, right? So, like, I think there's a risk there that it's more like, do they want to stay true to what they started in the beginning, or do they just want to add a ton of bullshit, and then, like, at the end, it's like, you know, crazy levels of storytelling, but it doesn't matter because each of those tangents will be told in their own game, in their own story, right? So I think that's also a possibility that we can keep in mind when, like, you know, thinking or discussing how the story will turn out. Like, how much do they want to stay true to what they already have built, and how much of a tangent do they want to go on in order to prolong the story and milk it as much as possible? I guess, like, maybe that's something that people don't really think much about because they focus on the story.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, for me, like, I see them totally going that direction if they wanted to. And, you well, know, what, make a shit ton of games.
Yeah, I mean, they certainly could. But, you know, the youngest member, I think, is Toriyama. And everybody else is kind of, it kind of feels like this might be their last game. Like,
well, I mean, you mean the original members, right? Because Hamaguchi is like 30 or something like that.
Hamaguchi's more of a programmer, too. I mean, he does have some story input, but, in terms of the people that are actually spearheading the game, like, I know Nomura is now, like, the overall project lead, and he's a little long in the tooth. Kitase is probably, I'm not even sure if he's going to make it through the actual remake series. It seems like he's kind of, like, he moved, I think he's moving into the, you know, Nomura is only 50. Yeah. I thought he was younger, so
Yeah, no, but it's like 50-something. She does say it's not that old.
No, I'm not saying they're old. I'm not saying they're going to die. Mm. Guys, I'm not saying that they're going to die. I'm not saying
you mean like retire, right?
I'm
like,
going to say retire. Like, yeah,
they'll hand off the duty or the concepts or whatever to someone else.
Right? I think they want to finish the games in their, you know, within their career. Or at least this story. Like, Remake, it feels like they want to finish Remake in their... as part of their lifetime. But like, you know, spin-offs are a thing. You know, that whatever version of the game, you know, like whatever's going on with Zach at the end, you know, maybe that's not, maybe that's not that he's gone into the live stream or into the Terrier universe. Maybe he's just gone into like an exclusive Xbox spin-off title. So that Square Enix has kept both companies happy. I'm obviously joking.
I do know that. I do know that Toriyama mentioned that. I think it was in the first Ultimania's interview that he was like, "This is probably going to be like my life project."
Yeah.
So he's like, you know, down for this to be like something that he's going to work on forever. So, yeah, you know, but that gives the implication that, like, they might have many things planned. I mean, who even thought about Ever Crisis, right?
Man, Ever Crisis, that's another one. You know, the thing I'm excited about Ever Crisis with, though, is that it'll be an opportunity for a lot of people to play what I think is the best compilation title that nobody got to play, and that's Before Crisis. Before Crisis the best story, best, like, most interesting game by far, but it was on, like, the least accessible system, which is,
I don't think anyone played it, like, actually played it.
Yeah. I mean, I only know about it because I've watched every scene on YouTube, you know, and, you know, I'm not sure if I was supposed to say that out loud, but I did, so, you know, here we are. So that does bring me to, I think, so just, I mean, you put out your tweets, and then sometimes people badger you about different things, and I'm sorry about all that. And if you're here and you're one of those people, can you stop? Thank you. I think, you know, she probably doesn't care because she's an adult and as like a business owner in Japan, and she doesn't care. You're nothing to her. But from me to you, you need to stop it, please. Thank you. I'd say the tweet that you put out recently that has the, it's not you, not your fault, but the most divisive part of the Ultimania's Plus, like, at least from a fan perspective, where, like, I'm hearing all these people going, like, oh, it's totally off the rails, it's ruined, is about Jesse's gloves. And that particular tweet
it was about the Toriyama saying, like, it's in a, you know, like, if they were going to all survive, this is some different world or something like that, right?
Yeah, the another story, another world tweet.
Right.
It was honestly, like, the way that you translated it, and I've heard a couple different translations of that particular segment, because I think it was the most potentially detrimental to where people think the compilation is going or where Remake is going, but
Right.
No matter how you read it, it is a masterclass in not saying anything, but also saying a ton. It is really vague. Like, he says, like, multiple things that contradict each other in the same sentence. It's a work of confusion art, if there is such a thing.
Oh, but, yeah. It's because, Right. It's someone actually asked me a couple days ago, like, is the way that I translated it, is it supposed to be a different world, or the world will be different? And I think that there's a big nuance there that is clear to me when I'm reading it, that it's like he's just, you know, casually saying like, oh, you know, the world's going to be different. It's a different world. But like, there is, I guess, like a difference between different world and the world will be different, right?
Okay.
And I guess that's the part that like people are saying. So like in the Japanese, it says like, So like, basically like the part that's, I guess, more controversial with the way that it's translated is like, chigau sekai ni natte shimau. So like, chigau is a verb. It means okay. To be different, or it means like, yeah, like making it like you make a mistake or it's different or, sorry, not making a mistake. It's just, it's different. Like the word chigau is just like to be different as a verb. And in Japanese, verbs can become adjectives if you put a noun after the verb. Mm. So like chigau sekai to me is a different world. Literally means different world. Ni natte shimau. So like ni naru means like to become. So like when it's like let's say like I want to become like a teacher, like sensei ni naritai, sensei ni naru. I became a teacher. I want to be a teacher. So like that's very straightforward. Ni naru is very straightforward. It just means to become. So it would technically be, if it was chigau sekai ni naru, it would be become a different world. But there's a nuance here where it says natte shimau. So like anything that has te shimau is it's usually like kind of a bad thing, or it's like it would be like, oh, like, I guess unfortunately this happened, or like, oh, maybe like this is going to be something that would happen and it might suck, or, you know, like there's a very, very like interesting nuance there. And then the last one, kamoshiremasen, is like maybe. So like he's basically saying, when I read it, he's just saying like, if everyone survives in the future, a different world, it will be, unfortunately, perhaps a different world. So like I translated it as, let me see what I wrote. Important theme of this story is loss. If all characters you see are able to survive in the future, then perhaps that would be in a different world. Yeah, so it will be in a different world, or like literally in a different world. So like someone asked me like, wouldn't it be translated to, let me see what they said. They asked me like, the world would turn out different if everyone got to live. I don't think that is the correct nuance, because the adjective for the world is directly as different world. So that should be put read together. So it's, different world will be. So unfortunately, will be a different world, like that.
Right.
So that's how I pieced together the translation. And I think that some people, like nuance-wise, they might be like, oh, that's, you know, actually it will become a different, the world will become different, but I don't think so. It's just like, it will be in a different world.
Like, maybe he's referring to our world. Like, because it's pretty impossible to say something like, an important theme of this story is loss, and then say, well, if they are able to survive, it'd be in a different world, but you get to be in that world. So like, if you get to be in a world that the theme isn't lost, then the theme is no longer loss, right? So it's a bizarre sentence to read. And it's also like, it's indicative of like, how hard it is to translate, and it's impossible to translate. Like, it is, you know, so that's why we're really appreciative of getting whatever nuance we can from you, because this is
a problem.
More than anything, I think what this bottom line is about, people want Aerith to die. I know that sounds cruel, like, oh, hey, why do we want Aerith to die? I think a lot of people really have associated the game's theme with loss, and a lot of people played this game for the first time when they were still learning about life. And so I know somebody that, you know, they lost their brother right before playing this game. You've actually talked to him before, and it brought, lost her brother right before playing this game. And the way that this game sort of just lets you grieve, it doesn't like give you any false hope, nothing like that. It's just like this very straightforward way to grieve that was really impactful to them. And so there's this fear that that's going to be taken away if that's what the, you know, if the remake takes that theme away. But what it seems like here is that Toriyama's trying to say, no, that theme's still here. And it's that last sentence that's just him trying to be like, I can't really tell you what's going on. Like, I have to be vague. Like, perhaps Jesse might also be spared or not. Like, he's just trying every sentence to be like, I can't answer any of this stuff, but the theme is lost. Relax. Like, that's what it feels like is trying to be said. Would you agree that that's basically it? Or do you think he's trying to let us know, hey, these people might survive in like the Xbox version of the game? or in the this Terrier verse, like we go into the Terrier stamp timeline and we play as a party of Zach, Biggs, and Jesse. And
I think that's the in the Japanese, the indicator for this sentence that kind of hints is the word tadashi. So like it says, he says, before that, he says like, you know, if Jesse might be spared or not, you know, like who knows, right? But the theme of this story is loss, right? Yet if everyone is to survive, then maybe it's in a different world. Like I don't think he even needed to say that if it wasn't something that they're already planning on the table. Because like you just said, but like, you know, the story is lost, so that's it. All right. You know, like, why would you even need to say that in this book if it wasn't something that they're actually actively thinking about?
That's like the theme of loss?
No, this different world of, you know, future, everyone's alive. Like, there's no reason for him to, like, kind of bait you with this. This book is very straightforward. It's telling us everything that, you know, characters are thinking about, everything that, you know, like what the intentions are or whatever. So if that was the case, like, why would he even need to say like, oh, maybe she will be spared? You know, like, it's very strange to me, like in this question and answer that like in a response to the question itself, is she alive? He says, yeah, maybe she is. But if she is, then I don't know, maybe it's a different world. Like, it's such a random thing to say and print in a book. If it wasn't to actually have some kind of repercussions later. That's, so, at least to me, that's how I read it.
That's fair. No, I mean, and that's, you know, I can't really say anything to that. I mean, it's, I think the concern comes in that the statement can't possibly be true, that the theme is loss, if there is some shortcut to loss. And so I think that's where people get confused.
Well, I mean, like, there's already loss that happened, right? So, like, all of the entire story happens because of loss from every character's background, right? There's some, they experience some kind of loss. So that already started the story. And, like, Barrett himself wants to save the planet from being, you know, like drained of all of his energy. He's trying to save the planet from getting, you know, losing, which is also like, you know, loss of the vitality of the planet. So that's already like an overarching theme that I think started the story anyway. So like, I guess it depends on the creators. Like, do they want to just keep on banking on that and making the story not a very, you know, like, I mean, a very, very real story compared to other Final Fantasies, I suppose. Or would they want to do something with the story that, like, yes, it still shows loss. Like, let's say Aerith doesn't die at the Forgotten City, but she dies elsewhere, you know, like at the end or something like that. Like, that's definitely a possibility, I think, that can tie into not only the theme, upholding the theme of loss, but giving people hope, but then still taking it away at the end, you know? And that's also something that would fit with the theme. But like, I don't think it's necessary for them to stick with what they created in the original, because mm-hmm. already we know this is a remake. For me, it doesn't matter if they take it one way or the other, if Aerith lives or Aerith dies. For me, it doesn't matter, as long as the story makes sense. Like if the story doesn't make sense, like out of nowhere, it's like, oh, you know, like she lives and everyone like lives in multiple timelines or some, like, you know, some crazy shit that happens. If it doesn't mm-hmm. make sense, then I would be like, what the hell? But then if it makes sense in the narrative that they build for this remake, then I'm okay with it. I'm very chill. Like, I don't have to really, like, have things happen in a way that I think it happens, because usually it doesn't. I don't really have much, like...
You got no stake in the game.
Expectations.
Yeah, it's like, whatever happens...
Yeah, I have no stakes, yeah.
Whatever happens. You're way better off than most of the fandom. Like, most of us have our headcanon so... narrow that whatever is going to happen is probably going to disappoint all of us. But
I'm in the mindset that like no matter what like happens is not going to be exactly how I would imagine it, no matter what. I'm, you know, we're not psychics. We can't read the minds of the developers, and who knows, like even during development something could be going one way and then let's say someone quits or, you know, someone gets replaced and then the story changes and no one knows that, right? No one will know that unless you work for them. So I think like for that, like for, I think it's dangerous to have, you know, so much like connection or so much adamant thoughts, you know, headcanons, mm-hmm. only to be disappointed at the end. I think it's dangerous in the sense that, like, you're just setting yourself up for possible disappointment if it doesn't go your way, you know?
And honestly, I can't think of good storytelling that I've been able to predict. Like, if I can predict it, it's usually not that good. I would like to be surprised. I would like to have a new story told to me. And I'm not saying all predictable things are bad. I'm not saying anything like that. So, but I'm saying that like the challenge of an artist is to, you know, is to really give a creative experience, meaning that something's been mm-hmm. created. That's sort of the basis mm-hmm. of all good storytelling, in my opinion, is that it generally challenges the form a little bit. And so, so I'm with you on that. I don't want to totally know what's happening. I want them to do what they want to do, and I don't want them to do it because they think that we want it, or I don't want them to think, you know, oh, well, you know, the fans will be happy if we, pull the audience to see who their favorite couples are and then make sure that everybody lives and, you know, makes that story happen. Like, but I don't mm-hmm. think that's what they're doing. I don't think that this is all fan service. I think they're telling a story that they want to tell. Might be a little different than what some of us expect, but like you said, if it's executed well, I'm here for it. Like, I think that the first game and Intermission and even the light novel has shown us that like they are putting so much love into this creation. And it is very creative. Like on the traces of two paths, like just Tifa's development is fucking rough. Like it's very sad. Mm. It's very intense.
Right.
It really develops like a complex character. And And from what I've read of Stanley, who's doing a really good job, you've linked Stan on your Twitter too, of the Aerith portion. That's a really deep, you know, like, I guess what I'm getting at is that the things that made Final Fantasy VII still seem to be at least 98% intact, but all the new stuff they're doing still feels like it's creative, it's interesting, it's innovative, And I think all the party members, you know, that are putting this together are doing a good job. You pointed it out, and something I noticed when I got my copy of the book is, in the very beginning, the lyrics to Stand Up Reprise, which is the Honey Bee Inn song, which is an absolute ode to pride, and there's obviously you know, some commentary on identity and being yourself and gender identity and you know, as a member of the queer community myself, that's super important. And I see that's written in English here, and and I look over at who wrote it. Toriyama wrote the lyrics to that song. And so it was one of those things that made me feel like, hey, Toriyama's made some weird stuff in the past. Don't get me wrong. I think 13 was a mess, et cetera. But I think that everything that he's putting his heart into here is coming across really well. I think the Honey Bee Inn was like an absolute, the apex of like remaking something, but from like a new lens, shattering everybody's expectations. Like, I don't know anybody that I care about that that didn't think that the Honey Bee Inn was like an absolute win. You know, like,
right,
just
yeah,
it was a slam dunk.
Yeah, so good.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And so, you know, I think we're kind of saying the same thing, which is that, you know, if they do it well and it makes sense, I'm here for it. And you're here for it, and we're better off because we would have no idea what's happening behind the scenes without you. So,
oh, no problem. Yeah, I mean, I want to know too, you know, what's going on. Like, not for like, you know, creating theories or lore crafting or theory crafting or whatever, but just kind of like, what are the you know, what are the devs thinking? Like, what exactly goes through their minds, you know, the development process and the storyboarding and, you know, script writing. Like, what are they thinking? What are the characters supposed to be interpreted like? Like, for me, I enjoy seeing, you know, like that behind the scenes stuff. So I don't really care about too much about like, you know, oh, I have this theory, I have this headcanon, I want it to be, you know, fulfilled. Like, I don't care about that. It's more like, oh, I really care about how the process works and like, how am I supposed to actually interpret this character, you know? How am I supposed to interpret that scene, you know? Like, oh, it's different, or oh wow, I thought exactly what I thought, you know? Like, that's interesting for me. Not being like right or you know, being wrong, it's just like seeing a glimpse of, you know, the process. And I think that's fascinating. So that's kind of like what I get out of it.
Speaking of like,
as a fan.
So, okay. Part two. What I know that you're kind of more interested in like the new stuff that's happening or seeing what new directions are going on, but you know, let's face it. We all took a trek through Midgar, and now we're out in the big, big world, and there's a bunch of cool stuff that happens out there. What are you most looking forward to in upcoming parts? In the next 10 or 12 parts.
So, yeah, I personally think there's going to be 4 parts.
Me too.
Yeah, I don't think they can wrap it up in 3 with the pace that they're going right now. And with the light novel showing that we are already going to be at Costa del Sol, I think that there's a good chance that part 2 will be like up until maybe Nibelheim. I don't think that like I don't think Vincent will be like an actual party member. I think Vincent will be like what Red was in the first part.
Yeah.
And I think part 3 will be like Sid is going to be the member that joins you, you know, like the extra member that joins you or whatever. So yeah, I think part 2 will be a lot of like I don't really care for it to be open world, but I do think it will be like kind of like FF 13 where you go to Grand Pulse and you have a big like area, a big map, yeah. right? Or like in FF 14, you know, there's a big map, and there's a lot of things you can see and people you interact with in that big map, but it still has borders. And you go through, you know, each section by like, you know, a trail or whatever.
Yeah.
Yeah. For me, I don't care about the open world thing. But like, the story wise, I think we will still start out in Calm. I think it will open with the flashback of Sephiroth, which would be a really cool cinematic and, opening and whatnot. And, I think what is building up right now is, Rufus is going to have a highlight in this. I think Rufus will definitely be, incredibly fleshed out. I don't know if it's going to be in part two or part three, but there's going to be some huge, in my opinion, in some huge developments with the Wutai War and how Rufus also is like working with Avalanche, which is a story point from before Crisis. I think they're going to bring that in and totally bank on that. And I don't know if it's going to be in part two or part three, but I'm almost 100% sure it will happen in some capacity. If it doesn't, then, you know, it doesn't. But if it does, it would be super exciting to see the direction they take with that. And especially because in the Ultimania Plus, they mention how, you know, Rufus came to Shinra's building to, like, foresee that there's some, you know, some shit that's going to go down. And also how Rufus can see the whispers, and people who can see the whispers are those who they think, they deem someone who might change the fate of the planet. Mm-hmm. So Rufus, of course, you know, Shinra itself is a huge factor in the story. And I think that instead of taking like a comedic way that they did in the original game with Rufus and like, you know, he's just kind of there and like when he shows up, he's like always laughing or whatever. Mm-hmm. Instead of taking like a comedic route, I think they're going to actually incorporate him into like the overarching story.
I agree. That was one of the most I kind of see it. I think that was maybe one of the most exciting things that came out of the Ultimania Plus was the two little Rufus tidbits. And this is something we talk about on the show often. And Rufus is a great example of a character that was actually really interesting and fleshed out in the compilation, but kind of flat in the original. And you can tell that the DNA of an interesting character is in the original. It's just there wasn't actual time to explore it. And the compilation made Rufus awesome. Like, he was he secretly funded Avalanche, and before Crisis, he was the he becomes sort of like the main fund behind the World Regenesis Organization, which is in Dirge of Cerberus. Like, they're the good guys, basically. Like, he goes through this, you know, really, really interesting transformation to make him an ultra complex character. Mm-hmm. And plus, his design in Remake is so badass. Like, he's just so cool. Mm-hmm. And so I'm really, I was really hoping that, you know, the new design meant that, you know, he was going to have a, like, I remember when the game was coming out, like, the Roberto Ferrari, like, images of him and all the belts and shit that he had hanging off him was there. I was like, oh, man, maybe he's going to be a bigger deal. Then when he could see the whispers, I'm like, fuck yeah, this guy, they're going full out. And so this is another example of what I think Remake is ultimately doing. It's telling the entire compilation through Remake. So now we get on the way to a smile episode Shinra elements in Rufus's development before Crisis and stuff like that. And I don't think there's anything bad about that. I think that's really good. I think if anything, it allows when the characters are considerably more rich and have better backstories, things like loss and these themes that everybody's really worried about losing, ironically, in the game, are gonna hit way more sincerely. Like, it's just going to be a much bigger impact if you care about the characters, if they're not these flat characters. And I'm not saying that Remake didn't have any missteps in the way that it characterized things. I'm like, there's some stuff that's just, it's whatever. But, you know, for I would say 98% is really good characterization. So what about Golden Saucer? Do you think I'm very excited for Golden Saucer personally.
Oh yeah, and also like Dine, Barrett's friend, Marlene's father. Like I think that will be super fleshed out too. I think definitely I don't know if the path that they take will be the same. I mean, we do know that they're going to go from Junon to Costa del Sol. Like that part is, I guess, confirmed through the book.
But, well, and then we also know
how they get.
Well, we also know that the Tifa section actually takes place between Calm and the Chocobo Farm.
Right. Yeah, like they're she's telling in they're kind of moving.
So that's like half the first game, basically. That's like half of, or that's half of part two.
Right. So I think that after Costa del Sol, after they get there, they're on the different continent, right? They're on the different part of the world. Maybe it won't be as linear as it was in the original, or like they might not hit the same places in the exact chronological order going up until you get to Nibelheim. But I think for the Gold Saucer, I'm kind of like unsure about how they're going to do it, because the first visit with the Gold Saucer is just like you go there and then you go to jail and and then you see Dine and then you leave. So like, will they have the Gold Saucer be a place where you come back frequently, like throughout the different remake parts, or will they kind of make it a original version in the remake where it's like they have everything that you need to do in the Gold Saucer at the Gold Saucer, you know, where it's like getting the key and everything as well, right? What was it, the key for the Temple of the Ancients or something,
to get the Black Materia?
So I don't know, like I mean I'm sure that the Gold Saucer is going to be amazing, but I just don't know like the story.
How are you going to get back there? How are you going to get back there? And how, when are you going back to Midgar? Is Midgar going to be the same when you go back, since it's probably like three games from now and on the PS7? So okay, something interesting that I'm surprised it took us this long to find, because again, when you have, I know you're like an immensely busy person with like this amazing life in Japan and everything, and like you're watching the Olympics with all these with all your friends and stuff like that. When you have time, I do recommend you check out my poor friend Sleepeasy's videos, because he's incredibly detail oriented, and that's the whole thing. Is like he's found insane details, like the horn on Behemoth Zero is specifically Azul's horn from like just these bizarre details. But one detail that we somehow missed completely, is that Chadley. First of all, Chadley is super sus, right? Like, can we just acknowledge what's going on? What's going on with fucking Chadley, right? So anyways,
he looks like well, I mean, I think since there was a someone who said like he looks like a young Sephiroth.
little baby Kadaj, yeah. He's got that little
It's Kadaj or
Sephiroth. Whatever. I'm the same difference, you know.
Yeah.
Okay, here's the other creepy thing about him. So he's a cyborg, right? So he's not like a robot. Right. He's a cyborg, and the difference is he used to be a real boy that Hojo like turned into a robot because Hojo sucks, right? And anyways, so he's got a pin on him. He's got this little pin on his pants that buttons, and that button, when I think probably just because Integrate is so high res, we were able to finally figure this out. That button is a picture of the Golden Saucer.
Oh, really?
Yeah. And so what's interesting, so I'm dead serious. So the Golden Saucer, by the way, on its own is a very strange button or like a very strange shape. Like the shape of the golden saucer is a representation of Yggdrasil, which is the Norse tree of life.
It looks like a tree, right?
Yeah, a Norse tree of life. And so it's like a counterpart to Sephiroth, which is the Judaic tree of life. It's called the Sephirotic tree of life. Anyways, I could go on. But so there is just like this possibility that it's supposed to represent something very, you know, metaphysical. But it is exactly the gold saucer. So why I'm even bringing that up is that it could potentially be a thing where Chadley becomes like your hub world, like where you can access all of the gold saucer games through Chadley throughout the map, including in future parts. Like, because I don't think we've seen the last of Chadley. You know, I think Chadley's...
Right. I think he's going to be pretty important.
And Chadley says weird stuff when you beat top secrets. He says, like, Cloud basically had infinite potential, and through the infinite potential that Cloud had, Chadley was able to break free of his cybernetic programming from Hojo.
Right.
Like, he was a spy, and then now he's not because Cloud's so infinitely potent. And so,
powerful or whatever,
and Chadley has the weirdest reaction to Cloud in a dress. Have you seen that?
Yeah. He's like, "Oh, ma'am, please don't look at me like that." Yeah,
you know, that's really funny. That's exactly it. You just nailed Chadley right there. Everybody, Audrey with the best Chadley impression I've ever seen. C cells, Sons of Avalanche. That's good.
Oh, man. You know, but yeah, I think Chadley is going to be someone very, very important to the story, because the extra scene with him and Vice was like absolutely mind-blowing. They didn't really need to like have him be important, but I guess he's important now.
He was so like, sassy, too.
Yeah, so sassy. He reminds me of Hope from FF13. Who like eventually, you know, becomes like the god or whatever of like the world. Because, you know, Chadley is he kind of like looks like Hope as well. And in FF13 Lightning Returns, Hope is like, you know, the commander of that ship or whatever they're on. And then he eventually gets possessed by the god. I forgot the name of the god.
He's the commander of the Yggdrasil, actually.
Sorry?
He's the commander of the Yggdrasil, actually. Ironically.
Oh, is that the name of the... Is that the name of the...
Yeah.
Like, whatever they're on.
Yeah. So, again, so, like, another connection.
Something like that.
Yeah.
Right, something like that. That he will be, you know, like, initially it's like, who is this character? This random VR dude. But now it's like, oh shit, he actually is like, you know, part of the Deep Ground. He understands the Deep Ground project, and like, he maybe even be someone who is like, you know, Hojo experimented on with Genova cells, and that's why he kind of looks like Sephiroth or whatever. Like, I don't know. Like, it could be, they can go so many ways with Chadley's character, and I think it might connect with Sephiroth or Hojo in the future as well.
Totally.
Yeah.
So I think, you know, at least that could be something that has gold saucer like potential for how we like. I think like he's even being set up that way, and I will post in our little private chat that picture so you can see, so that you don't think that I'm just making up details to gaslight you.
The picture of the no, it's all good. Is it a picture of the gold saucer from the OG, or like a reimagined gold saucer?
It's a 2D shitty image. Like, I think the gold saucer that we see in Remake will be like very done up compared to this. Here, I'm posting it now. But, so, you've been very patient, and we've been pretty much live for a couple hours. So, if I'm thinking, maybe we start the process of kind of wrapping this up. And so, if anybody's...
Oh, okay, sure.
If anybody's got questions, now's kind of the time to ask in chat. And as you know, highlighting is good. So if you can highlight them or at me, I'm more likely to see them. I've had alerts totally muted this whole chat. So if you've like followed or subscribed or given bits or any of that stuff, I just want you to know I really appreciate all the support that everybody has given. I can't do any of this without you. You guys are great. The VOD will be live tomorrow on YouTube, or today on YouTube if you're listening to me on YouTube. And you know, all of our links will be there. Please support you know, me, Sleep Easy, and Audrey on all the things, etc. And I do, for those people that are my Patreon subscribers, I have my first Mythology Morsel on Ifrit available there, but I am working on one that will be live tomorrow night, and it's going to be a doozy. Ifrit was about 5 ultra dense pages. This one's about 10. So look forward to that.
That sounds awesome. So much lore. Like, yeah, when you explained to me about all of the religion and mythology background, I was like, wow, I know about the Genova, Sephiroth, and so forth, but I don't really know much about the mythology part. So I was like, wow, that's very interesting that they, I guess Nojima is a, you know, a big lore or
mythology big mythology person, guy. Right? Yeah. He actually, before he joined, before he started working on any Final Fantasies, his first games were the Heracles series of games, which is the real name of Hercules. So right off the bat, you can tell he's Hercules, better than Disney at doing mythology stuff. And so he's got a real functional knowledge. It's not like the rest of Final Fantasy when they use mythology. It's usually more like honestly, like the first 5 games were just straight ripping off Dungeons and Dragons, like really, really off. Like, Bahamut's not even a dragon in mythology, and neither is Tiamat. But in Dungeons and Dragons, there's like Tiamat and Bahamut were like either husband or wife or brother and sister dragons, and then that exact
like in FF14.
Exactly. So the exact story was taken, and then it's become now it's like own mythology, like. All that stuff is now like Final Fantasy has its own mythology, which is cool.
Right.
But in the beginning, they were just ripping off Dungeons and Dragons. So let's take a look at chat here. Okay. Ars Omnia, who is one of my moderators, and thank you so much for all your help as always, Ars. Question, could a Sephiroth redemption story feasibly lead to a second fall from grace for the character, an earnest attempt at redeeming himself that just leads to greater tragedy for his character? I cannot help but be reminded of a line from The Usual Suspects: the greatest trick the devil ever pulled was convincing the world he didn't exist. Very thoughtful question, Ars. What do you think, Audrey?
I think, it really depends on how the developers write it, because it could go either way. It could go like, I think Sephiroth is going to be a tragic duotagonist, like a tragic hero, not a hero, but yeah, a tragic antagonist, I suppose.
Yeah.
Or a duotagonist. He might be set up for, you know, like a redemption or whatever, and then at the end he reverts back to his villainous self, and that's totally something I can see happening too, where it's like you kind of give people a little bit of like a glimmer, like, oh, you know, he could be good again, and then at the end it's like, oh no, evil is still evil, right? And I think that is a direction they can go with the character, or they can also just do something weird and, you know, have Sephiroth come back as like 4 different types or 3 different types or whatever, and then one of them is a good guy. I don't know. But yeah, I think it is very possible for them to like build up a character that looks like it will be redeemed, but then at the end be like, oh, actually, just kidding.
I think, you know, and I sometimes that kind of thing can come across as like manipulative to the fans. Like, what I've heard a lot of people say about like the potential of Aerith surviving is like, oh, well, what they're setting us up is this false hope, and then when she actually does die, it's going to be even more sad, and that's just really emotionally manipulative. I guess I can kind of see that, but also, like, you know, they're in this really impossible position with Remake, where like they've got to try and recapture the feelings of surprise and loss and stuff like that too. So again, it's back to your original point. It's like, if you can make it make sense, if you can execute it well, you know, we're probably going to look back favorably upon it. And right. With Sephiroth too, I think he gets so many Vader comparisons that, like, if they did exactly what they did with Vader, it'd be a little bit like he sacrifices himself in the end for Cloud or something. Mm-hmm. Something, you know, his one true love, and then you know, whatever, like, I can see that being kind of disappointing. But what it seems like they're setting up for him, for me anyways, is that they're setting him up to be not only a human now instead of just a monster or a force of nature, but like they're setting him up to be tremendously malicious. Like the recent description where we kind of finally got confirmation that the runaway Cloud line was actually his mother's line.
Yeah, that was messed up.
That's so cruel. So like that being instead like something that he's choosing to do, like instead of he's just this, he now has like this alien inside him and it makes him like want to destroy the, like, feast on the life stream, like him having like these actual motives and feelings, like him being so hateful and disenfranchised because he was, you know, experimented on a child, and he's like this tragic story. That's a lot, I think, more satisfying. I think if he ends up being bad, you know, but if he ends up getting some kind of redemption arc too, at least he'll have an explanation. Like, there's nothing that bad that can happen from them developing Sephiroth more at this point. Like, because he was not a very well-developed character, and they've already made a decision to develop him more. Like, he's already way fucking in this game a lot. There's, like, four of him, you know, and and he's, and, like, all the interviews. Yeah.
No, I was going to say, like, going back to, like, Chadley, you know, like, they can even do some crazy shit where it's, like, they, like, Sephiroth uses Chadley as a vessel or something like that, you know? Like, there's all this crazy stuff that can happen, I feel.
Okay, so I'm going to say one other thing about Chadley, because Sleepeasy's not here and he'll be mad at me if I don't say this. There's another thing that's really interesting about Chadley. And I know this is a complete diversion. Chadley has the same exact color scheming. Like, if you take the actual palette and compare the palette, because he's an artist, he's a color guy. Sleepeasy is, like, he's done most of my art and stuff like that. He's an incredible artist. He noticed that Chadley's outfit has the same color scheming value as the Moogle doll that Kate Sith rides on, or Ket Shi. So there's this, all this Kate Sith energy to him too. And I don't know what that means, but it's just, you know, it could be that the Moogle doll was also made by Hojo, and that Kate Sith is just like, or that that Chadley is just like the most advanced version of the Moogle doll, but also a living child.
Yeah, the only thing that I really hope that they do in the remake is just get rid of the Moogle doll. Like,
no!
I mentioned this in a previous stream before.
No,
It's gonna look so dumb.
Don't you want to just be running around the map,
the world
map? You're like, you're just like in this ultra serious fight with like the Ultima weapon, and then just out of nowhere, this Moogle doll.
This big Moogle thing.
Don't like, take this from me. Audrey, you can't take this from me. I need that. I need to one-hit KO the Midgar Zolom with that dumb Moogle with doll. With
a big ass Moogle. Like, that's the only thing I'm like, please, please don't have this in it.
Okay, but think about the alternative. Think about the alternative. We've got Kate Sith.
Yeah.
Riding on top of Chadley. That's creepier.
Okay. Or Red 13.
Okay, Red 13, yeah.
They can do, like, their, you know, the synergy thing that Sonon and Yuffie do, whatever, you know, like the pair battle or whatever.
You're ruining this for me, Audrey. I need my giant Moogle doll. I love that his weapon is a bullhorn. Like, just, it's just incredible. Okay. No, your feelings are valid on the subject. I'm sorry.
It'll be interesting to see what they do with it.
Like, okay. So, if he rides on Red 13, that's acceptable-ish. Vaguely acceptable. If he's riding on Chadley, though, like Chadley's in your party as the Moogle doll, that's going to creep me out. I'm not going to be able to handle that. I'm not going to be able to handle that.
Yeah, that would be a little weird.
Joe DNS really quick said, no question, but thank you so much for your contribution to our larger community. That's definitely to you, Audrey.
To you too. You know, Clark, you guys have all of this interesting lore that I'm sure, like, you know, many YouTubers and other theory crafters take from each other and, you know, craft more and more different things. So I think everyone is, you know, essential.
We get maybe 1/10 of the uncredited Screen Rant articles as you do, though, where people like, people like, oh, yeah. This is crazy.
journalism.
Journalism. You know, it is interesting that it used to be that, like, there were a lot of American journalists that lived in Japan for game news, and they would do the reporting and the translating. But that has just gone away. That's like so many. It's crazy to me how much I see your name in legitimate journalism. Like, that's nuts. They should pay you. I hope they do.
Nah.
I know you don't. I know. Okay. You got to be diplomatic. Question for Audrey. This is from Phantom Valentine, also a tremendous artist. And I'm sure you've seen him on Twitter because he responds to everything. He's everywhere. But if you actually click on his link, he's one of the best artists I've ever seen. Audrey, what is the response from the Japanese audience when it comes to the ending? Is it more or less the same as the West? What is their biggest concern?
I haven't really looked much into, like, lore, like, reaction videos. But I did watch a couple of reaction videos for Intermission's ending. And the general... Like, I watched several of them, like I would say about 10 or so. And the general reaction, especially with the Zach part, like, is like, oh my God, that's awesome. So I think it's, I don't know, like, how much, you know, the West is against the Zach, you know, timeline difference or whatever they have cooked up. But, like, from all of the reactions I saw for the Intermission ending, at least, it was mostly like, wait, what? That was crazy. Are you serious? That's so cool. Like, that kind of general reaction. So I think it's positive. For Japanese fans in general, they're very different with the way that they consume media. It's a very passive way of consuming media. Even if you're Japanese fans who are, like, very, very into their, you know, like, shipping or whatever. Like, it's very passive. It's just like, I enjoy this. I enjoy these characters and I enjoy this story. I'm just going to do my own thing. I'm going to just talk with people who think what I think, and that's it. Like, there's no conflict usually.
Right.
As opposed to the West. So, I think, like, Japanese, or at least, like, the majority of Japanese fans, not just for Final Fantasy, but for any kind of like anime video game related media is kind of they just take what it is as it is.
It's sort of more optimistic in general.
Yeah, I mean, I guess it's kind of like my way of thinking too. It's like whatever the developers do, it is to the, you know, it's to their own discretion. Of course, they take into account the thoughts of the fans and the opinions of the fans, but only to a certain degree, right? Mm-hmm. So in the end, like, even if you hate it, what are you going to do? Like, what can you actually do to change the way that it has already been done, right? So I think that's kind of like the way that like a lot of Japanese fans consume it. It's like, oh, well, this totally didn't agree with what I thought, but it doesn't matter because I have friends and I have a community I talk to who, thinks the same way. So like, that's kind of how the general consensus is for Japanese fans in various fandom spaces.
That's a great answer. And, from what I know, I've experienced the same sort of overall takeaway. It's just and I don't want to say that like, you know, either culture is wrong about the way that they consume things, but you know, there is a real distinction between like work and play in a couple of cultures. And I would say that I lived in Japan for a couple of years, and I would say that that is definitely one of those cultures where, you know, play is just like its own thing, and it's not supposed to be taken seriously. It's supposed to be, it's supposed to be escapism at its like at a very, you know, pure level. Like you're not supposed to take it that seriously. So, here in the West, there is a tendency to take your play very seriously. Like your intrinsically non-serious things seriously. And I'm not saying that's wrong. I think it's okay to, you know, one or have different things or be influenced by your culture, but it is definitely different. Now, that being said, it doesn't mean that everything that comes from Japanese developers is going to necessarily not consider all of its fans or not care about the message it's sending. Like you could take Nier, for example. Nier is a great example of something that is not just trying to make everybody happy. Like it's essentially sadness porn. So like, it's trying to tell the story it wants to tell, and you can take it as seriously as you want. And it makes that really clear. So from Ryan.
Yeah, I think, go ahead.
Well, from Ryan. Question for Audrey. Is Zach an Asian?
Is Zach an FF14?
I get the connection you're making. I get the connection you're making, Ryan. Very funny. You're big. Real quick, we'll just take a little 14 segment. You seem to be really enjoying 14 right now.
I love it. I honestly think it might be the best Final Fantasy story ever.
That's great. And and you're not even to Shadowbringers yet.
So I'm not even in Shadowbringers yet. And I honestly think that this FF4, like, so I mentioned this many times in my previous streams of FF14, but like nostalgia aside, everyone has their, you know, favorites, like FF10, FF9, FF8, FF7, you know, the golden period of Final Fantasy. But nostalgia aside, I think, like, taking out that bias of, like, oh, I love this game. I love FF7 or FF8 or FF9, FF10 because I grew up with it. You know, I played it when I was a kid or whatever. Like, taking that out of the equation and just looking at it at a, like, a purely, like, you know, story perspective, I think FF14 is probably the best Final Fantasy story among all of the Final Fantasies. Only because it's so well thought out. It's like an anime, or like it reminds me of like an anime or a manga series where it's like things that come up like really randomly in the beginning that you're just like, oh, what was that? Oh, whatever. Like it actually comes back later. throughout the story, and it's a key plot point. And it's just crazy that like there's so many references that in if you didn't play a Realm Reborn, you would like definitely miss out on it. But like if you played Realm Reborn, yeah, it's boring, but it it sets up so much lore to go like to have a payoff at the end. And so I think like it's mind blowing. I honestly think FF 14 is like a masterpiece.
I think that's generally the consensus for anybody that's made it all the way through. The people that have survived through A Realm Reborn and then got into the better bits. So we'll definitely have you on for SEAL Team 14 when that's a thing.
For sure.
Is Zach Ganassian, though? That was the question.
I don't really understand the reference at this point, but like Asians are like Organization 13, right? And they hop in different timelines or something. I don't know. I'm not at that point yet.
That sounds like Kingdom Hearts, but okay, we'll move on from Final Fantasy 14 because nobody's here for the 14 lore, unfortunately. Erdix asks, do you think Kate Sith's fleshed out iteration for Remake will end up tying more directly to all this new Shinra tech we've seen, including Jadli, or possibly line up Reeve to cross paths with Hojo more directly? Alternatively, any Reed tidbits you've run across? That actually is a good question. Is there any Kate Sith stuff in the Ultimania?
Yeah, let me check right now.
While you're looking at that, I will. So, the lore behind how Kate Sith works is absolutely baffling. Okay, so Reeve, do you know how? So, how, according to the lore, how Reeve controls these puppets is with a power that he was born with called Inspire. I'm not making this up. So, when he was like a child, he was able to like shut down a reactor with his mind. And so Shinra hired him. So he's like a powered human. And he uses Inspire on these puppets and these animatronics, and that's how he's able to control them. So he's like a special human. And so he was taken by Shinra, and that he was separated from his parents, who speak with a dialect that's different than him, but he learned to speak like a more proper dialect. That's why in like Dirge and in Advent Children, Ketchi speaks with an Irish accent because it's like a accent version of Japanese, but like since Ketchi is a Celtic or Gaelic,
right,
you know. Character, but so the way he uses it, like I would have guessed that it was some kind of like VR goggles he puts on, like he puts on an Oculus and has these little, you know, these little things that he walks around as Kate Sith with. But no, according to the lore, he's like got telekinesis powers that apparently work across the goddamn globe, which by the way is smaller than the state of Texas, so I guess that's not that big of a deal. But, like, the whole thing behind how Kate Sith's powers work and Reeve's works, according to the lore, is so backwards that I hope they completely retcon it and just, like, do something cool with the technology. To answer your question,
Adrix. I had no idea. but Reeve, there isn't anything specifically talking about like his connection with Kate Sith in the Ultimania, as I checked. She's not even in this Ultimania Plus, so
okay, I didn't think so, sure. But yeah, like sometimes like they don't make it easy for you and like put the picture of the thing that the thing is about next to the text to help you find the thing, and I didn't see any pictures of him, but I don't know, you know.
Yeah, she's not. I unless I like haven't gotten to it yet, because there's just so much material in here. But I don't see right now from like flipping through anything about Reeve.
That was, you know, okay.
If I do, I'll I might post about it. So
I was pretty surprised looking through the Ultimania Plus. There's nothing about Zack. There's like nothing about the about the Zack scene other than like the stuff that shows up in the script that you know you've posted. Right. There's like
nothing.
There's nothing about
such a letdown.
Nothing about Stan.
Such a letdown.
Like there's even a picture of like the end scene with where Zack opens the door to the church, and then under it is just a bunch of developer commentary about straight up nothing.
It's just about like, oh, you know, and in this scene in Calm, it's supposed to be like a, you know, a moment where they are just chilling. You're like, okay, great, but what about Zack? You have a picture in here. What the hell?
What's going on? Is he alive?
What's going on?
Is he in the live stream? What the fuck's going on with all these dogs on these bags? Where's my chihuahua stamp? Everything. I hear you. I hear you. Okay, let's see. Two more questions, and then we're gonna raid somebody at midnight. Let's see.
I see one here that says, Audrey, you translated something from the material Ultimania that had the cutscene director say they were trying to show a fearsome and powerful side of Sephiroth at the edge of creation. And they wanted the scene to respect the OG as well. Does this indicate that Sephiroth is evil here, or just that Cloud is afraid of him? That is not in the Material Plus Ultimania.
It's in the original Material Ultimania.
I have to find it.
That was one of those.
I do remember it though.
Yeah, the Material Ultimania though, it's not the it's generally like a particular artist that answers all those questions. It's not like necessarily Nojima or Nomura. The one that
it's
was
kind of like their interpretation.
Like, and so you don't know what they're told. Like, there is that bit in Material Ultimania that says that the whispers were based on the where somebody like Nomura told this designer, "Hey, build the feelers." Like sort of like the elements from Nier, the souls of the dead in Nier, like, and you're like, okay, does that mean anything? And he's just, it's just what Nomura told him to like use as a template, or the galaxies in the background, like while you look for this, the galaxies in the background, there was a some artist that was he was tasked with designing galaxies to go in the background for the edge of creation scene, and they're said to supposed to be look like wings. And if you look at the pictures in the Material Ultimania, and I can't show you them here, you're just gonna have to take my word for it, they look nothing like the ones that actually end up in the game, and they both look exactly like wings. Like, it's very upsetting how different they are. But did you you find that a little bit?
Oh yeah, I found it. Okay, so it's a cutscene director Miyake. He wrote, "I actually did not think we would be putting the scene in the remake. The concept of the scene was to make sure that it respected the original game as well as showed a very fearsome and powerful side of Sephiroth." And this is for the Edge of Creation part. I cannot find the actual part in the book. I wish I wrote the page number so I can see. But I don't think it's like I don't think it's like supposed to be that deep, that it's like they're trying to like have respect to the original or whatever. You just wanted to show like Sephiroth looking kind of, you know, powerful. Because it's a the cutscene director, like Clark mentioned, it's just, you know, like they get some cues, but it doesn't actually have to be like, you know, related to the story or so forth. At least that's my interpretation.
We'll say this is the last question, and then we'll wrap up here. This is a great question, and it's from This Girl Are Sick. In the scene where Sung takes Aerith from Seventh Heaven, there's a moment of slow motion as she passes him. Does the Ultimania Plus say anything about that? And
let me see. There is that scene in the Ultimania Plus.
Yeah, I have not looked at that either. At all.
Yeah, let me see.
I see it, but
let me just quickly look at it. All right.
Right, because on that page is where the question about Marlene comes from. But and you posted that.
Right. It doesn't really say about, like, it's just saying that, like, Aerith was trying to make sure that Marlene is not, like, scared, and so she tried to be, like, you know, ensure that, like, it's going to be okay for Marlene, so that's why Aerith is very, like, she looks very strong and, you know, headstrong, I suppose. Let me see if there's anything at the end. Yeah, not in particular. I mean, just like the Aerith has a space of like, she's like determined to make sure that Marlene doesn't get scared, to make sure that like she can show Marlene that it'll be okay. So I guess that's kind of like the, it doesn't refer to anything about like, you know, Song knows Aerith from the past or anything like that. There's nothing like, nothing mentioning that from my skim through. But I can, it is kind of interesting though. I can translate this later and post it, maybe like later tonight or something. That'd but yeah, nothing about like, Song's like, knowing that, you know, Aerith is whatever, like, you know, the any of the history of the past or whatever. It's more about Marlene in this scene.
Yeah, definitely. Well, that was a great question though. This girl are sick, thank you. Are you gonna read through the light novel, you think? I mean, just to take a gander at it. There's no stamp in there. Are you gonna read the light novel like on your own time, you think?
Oh yeah, I haven't had time to read it yet, but I probably will on my own time.
I already gleaned like, through it for a stamp. Don't worry, you don't have to do that. It's not in there.
I mean, there's no stamp. Yeah, I remember I was skimming through it. I didn't see anything about stamp.
Yeah.
So what was the info or like the thing that you could take out of it if there was stamp in the light novel?
So if we know what, okay, so. Like, if we see Terrier stamp, it sort of tells us what's happened. Like, what it's told us is that the entire past has changed and the whole party has walked into, you know, the Terrierverse. And
the Terrier one is the one that is the Zach one? Or?
Yeah, where the Beagle is the stamp that we see, like, all throughout Remake. We see it in...
Oh, right,
like,
right.
Yeah, Beagleverse is the one we're playing in Remake, including Yuffie's chapter. And then for whatever reason, just in that one scene, this bag floats by and it's the exact same bag. It even says original on it and it's the Terrier. And that's when everybody's mind went, oh, this is going full Marvel. Like, this is the multiverse theory and Zach's going to be alive in the Terrierverse. And it's going to be a spin-off game for the PSP5, you know, right. The whole thing that everybody went into. So what we, if we find out, like, we get to Calm and the Whispers have all been defeated now and we get to Calm and like the first stamp bag we see or first indication of stamp is a Beagle. It means that wherever Zach is somewhere completely different. If we see it and it's a Terrier, then what we know is that the party has been isekai'd into, you know, the
Zach's world, the world where Zach's alive. Yeah.
And theoretically in that world, the Whispers died, and were not there to prevent the death of the party. Cause remember, most of the party dies, like, and then gets resurrected by, either, you know, unstabbed, you know, like Barrett did, or like on the highway when like they die like five times and the whispers prevent them from dying. They wouldn't, that wouldn't be the case in the Terrierverse because the whispers are gone. And so Zach's probably alive by himself and the rest of the party died. But now there's this new party from the Beagleverse that have like singularity. That's one of many theories on the mess that is the Beagles. Right, right. But if we found out what stamp was, because I think nobody thought that we would get any glimpse of the future in these books, right? In Traces of Two Pasts, like past is in the title, right? So we didn't know that we would get little glimpses. And that was, I think, the thing that everybody was really surprised about. I think people were actually really upset about that, in fact, too. Like, they're like, what? It's in the future? I have to have this book to know what's in the future? The answer is you don't. Like, you just play it when part two comes out, it'll probably tell the same story. But so that was why I that's so for the audience, I have been asking Audrey, like, hey, can you look for stamp in the book? You'd be like, oh, look, just back off.
I mean, I didn't see any reference to stamp, but I mean, even if there were, I don't think they would have written like, oh, and it specifically looks like a terrier, you know. So even if they had a reference to stamp, I feel like it would still be vague.
Yeah, it would be a huge misstep for them to tip their hand like that. Like it's a mystery. They don't want us to know just in case they find out that the direction that they're going is really bad and they need to backpedal.
Right, exactly. Yeah, I think, I mean, there's a lot of stuff that they could do with it moving forward. I mean, no matter what they do with part two and beyond, like, I'm for it. You know, like, it will, I'm sure there'll be some parts that'll be like, huh, that's kind of weird, but oh well.
That's but, a great attitude.
I'm very, very, like, I'm very chill with these kind of things. Like, I don't expect it to ever, like, you know, happen the way I want it to happen or whatever. And if it is something completely surprising, like, that's great. If it's something that I also predicted, that's also great. You know, like, doesn't really matter to me. I'm just here to, like, play it and have fun.
What are you most excited for in the coming year?
Games? FF16.
I'm way into FF16. I too have been
an Endwalker.
I just like you, have been a full scholar at Clown College for expecting these FF16 trailers to hit. But but it sounds like
with a PhD in Clown University.
Well, yeah. You know what it sounds like they're doing is really smart, which is like they're gonna have the game mostly done by the time we see the next thing, and it'll be ready.
I think the
to
next
release.
Time we see it, or if not, like to release at least like maybe a demo. The next time we see it. So I mean that's fine. I'll wait then. You know, I can wait for it instead of being like, you know, fed just little bits here and there. Like, you know, it's fine.
Totally.
But that's what I'm most excited for in the next I guess fiscal year for Square Enix's IPs, FF16 and Endwalker for sure.
Right on. That's awesome. Okay. Well, I cannot thank you enough for being my guest here. And again, Sleep Easy, so sorry that he couldn't be here for you guys and for Audrey. And please wish him and his all the best.
Oh yeah, no problem. I really hope he and his family get, whatever issue he had. Hopefully, they're all okay.
Yeah. So, if you guys can all do me a favor and make sure that if you're not following, follow Audrey on Twitter, and please support her store. If you need anything that is hard to get, because it's not sold here, and you know I use the site constantly. I get all of my Ultimanias from her. I get
thank you so much.
A great great way to get reliably shipped from Asia. So please check that out and support that. And we're gonna go ahead and see who's live, and then we will do a raid.
Oh yeah, but thank you so much again for this interesting conversation about Sephiroth and redemption. I don't know, you know, what kind of direction that the devs would take the game, but I'm super excited to see how it turns out. So yeah, I'm very chill. Like, I, whatever happens with it, I'm just, you know, it's great. It'll be great, I'm sure. It'll be fun.
I love that attitude. That's great. I wish I had that kind of attitude. If only time and and privilege hadn't jaded me. So who we're going to raid, by the way, is we're going to raid Susie Jung, who is the English VA for Yuffie. She is currently...
Oh, awesome, awesome.
She's currently streaming Final Fantasy X.
Oh, cool.
So we're going to raid her. And so all the love that you've given me through all of this has been wonderful, guys. And I would like you, if possible, to spread the love of SEAL Team 7. And the positivity of SEAL Team 7 to Susie Jung, please follow, please say hello, just say hi, and thank her for her wonderful job in FF7R. So we
thank you guys so much.
Oh my goodness, 25, 32, 38, 41, 48, 50. All right, guys, I love you all. Good night.
Bye.